हरि ओम स्टार्ट विद द प्रेयर ओम समस्त जन कल्याणी निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं त्वमेव माता च पिता त्वमेव त्वमेव बंधुश्च सखा त्वमेव त्वमेव विद्या द्रविडं त्वमेव त्वमेव सर्वं मम देव देव त्वमेव सर्वं हृदेव देव हरि ओम सो वी आर एनालाइजिंग एज अ पार्ट ऑफ द फंडामेंटल्स ऑफ अद्वैत वेदांत व्हाट इज जीवा और हु इज जीवा And what is the locus of avidya? So jiva is, we said, there are five components, and that includes three shariras, that is sthula, sukshma, and karana sharira, the gross body, subtle body, and causal body, and the reflected consciousness, because the bodies themselves are inert. And the reflected consciousness which makes the bodies active, and that cannot but happen whenever there is a subtle body and whenever there is an original consciousness, reflection will occur, and there is original consciousness OC or original consciousness which is all pervading. So all components are involved in the jiva, because without the original consciousness there is no reflection. And there cannot be any reflection unless there is a subtle body. Subtle body cannot be there until you have a locus for it to express itself, and therefore there is a gross body. All that involved. And the subtle body itself came into the picture because of the vasanas, which are karanas. Karana means cause, therefore it's called causal body. Because vasanas are cause for my butt. Therefore, they are cause. Therefore, in the karana sharira, in the causal body, only that alone remains, and that's what is the state during the deep sleep state. And now, each sharira will be traveling. When I in the waking state, I am using all the components. In the dream state, the subtle body, because the identification with the gross body is not there. Even though gross body is still functioning, but identification with the gross body is not there, and I am only identifying with the subtle body. And if I go to a deep sleep state, I am only identifying with the causal body, the vasanas predominantly. And I say, I do not know. And because of the lack of knowledge of the duality, because of the subject-object relationships are not there, it's a homogeneous I do not know, without any differentiation, and that's what is called akhanda akara ajnanam, that is homogeneous ignorance. In that you cannot ask question, there where is ignorance, who has the locus of ignorance, all these questions cannot be answered because I cannot analyze systematically the nature of the ignorance, because in order for me to analyze systematically, I need to have a mind, and therefore once the mind is there, I am now putting something else besides the causal state. Now all that are implied. Now when I inquire into the question of who has the avidya, avidya cannot be with the original consciousness. So it cannot take, because it's a pure, and in the five components of the jiva, because I remember five components is original consciousness, the reflected consciousness, and the reflecting medium consists of the causal body, the subtle body, and the gross body. So this is a reflecting medium, and reflecting medium itself is inert, but it has to be activated by the reflected consciousness. Reflected consciousness cannot occur unless there is an original consciousness. All that is implied. But original consciousness cannot be known in these components, but that's exactly what the point is. When you say Tattvamasi, Tattvamasi means you are that, is not talking about from the point of the five components, what is the equation that is really valid there. Equation is not at the terms of Sthula Sariram is that, or Sukshma Sariram is that, or a causal Karana Sariram is that. Neither of the three bodies, not even the reflected consciousness is that, but it is the original consciousness, one of the five components of making up the jiva. So equation of, or the jnanam involves recognition of these five components. What counts is that which is changeless entity, since everything else is changing. So that's what one has to be careful. Say, who am I inquiring? Who am I inquiring is trying to find out. I am that who is changeless entity in spite of all changes. So it's not the gross body, it's not the subtle body, it's not the causal body, it's not even the reflected consciousness that I am. I am the original consciousness that because of the reflection occurs. Reflection occurs because there is a subtle body there. Subtle body is there located in the gross body. So all components have to be understood. Now when somebody criticizes Advaita Vedanta, it cannot be and all that. Question is, what aspect of it they are referring to? So therefore, jiva involves all the five components, and when Advaita is pointing, Advaita means non-duality. Non-duality is eliminating all the duality, is not really real or not substantive, and what is real is that which is homogeneous, changeless entity in all this. So in me, the changeless entity is only the OCA, the original consciousness that is getting reflected. So jnanam is that, that is Vedanta is trying to point out in the direction for me to recognize the fifth component, in all the five components that are involved as the real component. Everything else is only apparently real because they are changing. Reflection changes depending on the reflecting medium, not the original consciousness. Original consciousness may be same, but because of the reflecting medium is there, depending on that is essentially the reflection also changes. So Krishna gives example, if it is covering is only, if the medium is covered by simple smoke, all you have to do is put the wind away and then the mirror is clean, so reflection can be there. But if there is something foggy, the mirror has some more dust in it, then I had to do wiping. And if the dust is lot more sticking, lot more, then I had to really polish it in order to make reflection is maximized. And that's exactly purification of the mind. So purification of the mind is removing the wrong notions in the mind. So where are the wrong notions? Wrong notions are in the mind. Wrong notions come into picture because of lack of knowledge. So all this, now who has the lack of knowledge? That's why in the 13th chapter of Gita, it says, Kshetrajnam Chapimam Vidhi Sarva Kshetreshu Bharata. Kshetrajnam is the jiva and mom refers to the Paramatma. Know me as the Kshetrajna in all fields. So in every field there is a OC, that is the original consciousness is there, that is getting reflected, and the reflecting media can be different. One media can be different from other media. So what exactly jiva? Jiva is includes the original consciousness, which is changeless, and all other changing things. When I say I am, so what am I referring to? Without any further qualifications of one of the bodies, if I say I am referring to the original consciousness, because I am same one who was originally in the baby stage and in the growing up a toddler stage and an adult stage. So the body change, antakarna, the mind change, antakarna change, my vasanas also keep changing, everything of the five of the four of the five components changing. Therefore reflection also changes because the reflecting medium is changing. So Chidabhasa is also changing. What is changeless in all the changing things is only that which is the original consciousness. don't think that original consciousness is only one component there in the five components. It's not like a five different things mixed together, because the original consciousness is what? It is Brahman. Brahman means there cannot be anything other than Brahman. So even that original consciousness is also present in the antakarana, in the subtle body, gross body, also in the form of existence. So therefore, in the form of existence also it is there, but therefore in there also there is the original consciousness are expressed as existence. So existence is not a part or a property or a product of any object, including the gross body or the subtle body or causal body, but it pervades all the bodies, yet it's different from all the bodies, and it's because of which they exist and without which they cannot exist. So that is also Brahman is everywhere in the reflecting medium, in the original consciousness, and also in the Chidabhasa, because there cannot be anything other than Brahman. So one has to be very careful in terms of this mixture of five components. When we say they are components of not of parts, because Brahman cannot have any parts. So it's all pervading, homogeneous presence everywhere, and it is a changeless entity in all changing things also. So when the body changes, when the mind changes, when the causal body or karna sarira changes, vasanas change, there has to be some entity that is changeless in all the changing things, and that is again Brahman. So when I say, that's why in the Chandogya Upanishad, when we use Tattvamasi statement comes after introducing pure existence alone was there before, so it exists continuously even in the reflecting media also, it is exists. And what is there is it's changeless in the changing things, and that's why aitadatmyam idagum sarvam tat satyam. So before he says tattvamasi, the more important statement is aitadatmyam idagum sarvam. This idam sarvam, this changing things, idam jagat also, there has to be changeless entity, that is Brahman. Even though it is inert entity, there the Brahman is expressed only as the existence aspect of it. That's why existence alone was there, now it expressed into many, both in terms of inert, which is called the gross elements, and also the subtle elements, all that is implied. So when it says the antakarana is a defective, it's not the original consciousness is getting defect, it doesn't have ignorance at all from the point. So we said Brahman cannot have ignorance. At the same time, ignorance cannot be away from Brahman also. So all both statements are valid. So when we say now, to what is the locus of that? Locus has to be a conscious entity, but not inert entity. So what is that in the Bhashya of Shankara Bhashya in the 13th chapter, when he says about it is the antakaranam is involved, antakaranam supported by the reflected consciousness, that is supported by original consciousness. All are implied in the process of jiva. But the defect is with the antakaranam, because I can purify the mind, therefore I can change from jnana, vajnana to jnana, or avidya to knowledge when I gain the knowledge. So the criticism that the jivatma cannot be equal to paramatma, why? Because jivatma has avidya, paramatma doesn't have avidya, therefore you cannot mix one with a defect and one without a defect, and that's the equation is not valid. That's a puropaksha, that's an objection against the statement Kshetrajnam Chavyam Viddhi Sarvakshetri Shubhadra Bharata. Says it is a Mahavakya where Jivatma is same as Paramatma, is identified. Kshetrajnam is a Jivatma, Mam referring to a Paramatma, and these two are, I am the same one who is the Kshetrajna in all Kshetras, not just one particular Kshetra, in all Kshetra means field, in all fields I am the one who is really Kshetrajna, knower of the field. So the knower known is only me only, because known is also my manifestation only, because I became many. That includes the Panchabhutas as well as the modification of the Panchabhutas into inert things, subtle as well as gross elements. Therefore, now who has the avidya is now should be clear. It is the jiva has the avidya in the sense that in the jiva component we are referring to the one with the antahkarana. That means the inner instruments. We cannot say body has ignorance. Body's gross elements cannot have ignorance. We need to have a conscious entity, and therefore conscious entity is illumined beautifully in the subtle body, and therefore it is from starting from the chidabhasa, that is reflected consciousness, from down on along with the antahkarana, all the instruments that has the ignorance. So ignorance rests with the mind, predominantly mind and intellect, where the impurity is. Because when I say I am ignorant, I say my body is ignorant. We do not say it is the intellect that is making a statement, and it is the intellect that has to gain the knowledge. Therefore, the ignorance rests with the intellect only. And Shankara goes through five arguments to support this in refuting the Purvapaksha, refuting the objection raised against the statement that the Jivatma cannot be equal to Paramatma, because Jivatma has the ignorance. So Jivatma cannot have ignorance. If we talk about Jivatma here, original consciousness, only the reflecting medium which are changing is the one, and if you identify with that, then there is a problem. But the statement that when you see Kshetrajnam Chapimambiddhi Sarva Kshetriyeshu Bharata, that statement is valid only from the point of the original consciousness that is getting reflected in a particular way. So it's not the reflected consciousness, not the reflecting medium. Equation is only valid at the level of Mahavakya, means identity of Jivatma and Paramatma. That identity relation comes only when you understand the structure of the whole Jivatma as per Advaita Vedanta. So we have to understand what exactly Jivatma is. So when I take myself that I am only this particular bodies, including reflected consciousness and reflecting medium, if I take myself only as that, then I have a problem, and I am taking the Arivo. Sorry, there was a break due to internet. We will continue on here. We are analyzing the what is Jivatma, and where is the ignorance in the Jivatma components that we are talking about now. So of the five components of that, one is the original consciousness, another is the reflected consciousness, and the reflecting medium consisting of the causal body and the subtle body and the gross body. And in most of the cases, people only refer to the original consciousness, Karana Sarira, and the reflected consciousness. Only three aspects or four aspects: the original consciousness, the reflected consciousness, the causal body, and the Sushma Sarira. And in some cases, you refer all the five components, including the Sthula Sarira. But when we are referring to the avidya rests, or the ignorance rests with the intellect only. Because when I say I do not know, who is making a statement? It is an intellectual statement. I do not make a statement, I do not know. Even though I do not know, I won't make a statement in the deep sleep state, because I need the buddhi to even to make a statement. And I do not know means I am a knower, and this is an object of my lack of knowledge also. So here we are talking about the analysis of the antahkarana itself, which claims that I know, I do not know. So Shankara, in response to the objections raised by the Purvapaksha, that means an objector, that they cannot be equal, Jivatma cannot be equal to Paramatma, because Jivatma is a defective, Paramatma is perfect, you cannot equate these two. How can you be equal to the Paramatma? So this equation is only valid at certain level of what Jivatma means. So this has to be very clear. And therefore, from the point, it says Jivatma also doesn't have the ignorance. When you say jivatma doesn't have ignorance, now we are talking about only from the point of pure consciousness, that which is localized as though in the particular place or particular individual. Now, to understand this clearly, you can use the reflection of a moon, for example, and this concept will become very clear. So when there is a sunlight, and Purnami day, that is full moon night, when I look at the moon, and the look at the moon, I say the moon is shining. Because if I go beyond the moon from a distance, there is no other illuminating or luminous object, unless I found at a further distance there may be a small another planet or stars there. So when we say other planets is out there, the Gruha, the Mercury and Venus and all other the planets which are also not luminous but are able to see because of the reflection of the sunlight. Now looking at the moon, and when I say I am seeing the moon is a luminous entity, now I am identifying what component? I am identifying moon at the gross body level as the satellite, the moon itself as a matter, and there is a reflection of the sunlight that is essentially the RC or reflecting consciousness, and there is an original light that is getting reflected. So the original light is there, original light is sunlight is there where the moon is, and moon is there reflecting medium, and the reflection is also there because the moon is reflecting. So how bright the moon is and how shining depends on the reflecting medium. If the sunlight is uniform and there is no change in the sunlight at all, so it is a changeless entity, and now when I look at the luminous moon, I had to see at least three components there. One is the original sunlight, another is the reflected sunlight, and the third is the moon, the reflecting medium. And if the reflecting medium suppose become an active one, it says, hey, I am self-luminous entity, I am a conscious entity, I am an existent entity, and if the moon starts claiming, then we have a problem because moon itself is not a conscious entity. Now the purification of the moon involves the purifying the medium of reflection only, and that's what essentially, and not the sunlight we don't need to purify, and the reflection consciousness or reflection will also get purified if we change the reflecting medium. So essentially the purification of the moon involves the reflecting medium has to be changed, because that's where the dirt is, that's what to be polished. So if the avidya is considered as a defect, and the defect has to be removed, and the removal has to be done by in the antahkarana, in the reflecting medium, and that has to be polished. And this has to be understood now. Therefore, this, when I go to a doctor, problem of seeing, I have cataract problem, and the doctor is going to change or do something with my karana. Karana means instrument of seeing, and not the self that I am. I am a seer using an instrument, and the instruments are defective, and the defect belongs to the instruments, and it's the instruments that need to be corrected, and in the process, once the instruments are corrected, I can see beautifully and I have no more problem of seeing. So this is exactly what the first argument of the Shankara in refuting the Purvapaksha. The second argument is, it says, because I know ignorance. So when I say the antahkarana, the buddhi says, I do not know that I am Brahman, or this is Brahman, or the statement of the one that is being pointed out by Vedanta. I do not know, or you can translate it, I do not know that I am the source of happiness myself. I am looking for happiness, I do not know that I am source of happiness, because happiness is equated to Brahman, because limitless alone is the happy state. So if I understand all these components here, so when we say that drishyatva, this is second argument of Shankara, because I know ignorance, because I know its presence as well as its absence. A student who is seeking knowledge, he is going going after, don't turn it on, Amma. Don't turn that one on. Okay. When the student is going after the ignorance, when the student is going after knowledge, that means he has a knowledge, he knows that he is ignorant, therefore the ignorance is knowable entity. That means there is a knower and this is known. This is drushyatva. It means it's an object of knowledge. When something is an object of knowledge, object is different from the subject. So I am the knower and this is a known. Therefore, I am the knower. I cannot be object. Subject cannot become object. Object cannot become a subject. Therefore, I cannot have ignorance. Ignorance is I am aware of. That means something that is come and goes. Therefore, I am not ignorant, but only the karanam, the instrument is doesn't have the knowledge. That also has to be understood. Therefore, the knower, the ignorance is also an object of knowledge, and also knowledge also, the teacher knows that he knows, and that means he knows the absence of the ignorance. Student knows the presence of ignorance. So therefore, both are objective knowledge. Therefore, the subject I am is independent of the object, free from the object, and that also has to be understood. And the third argument is, essentially, I am asangaha, according to the pure consciousness, asangoham, asangoham. So I am untouched by anything. That is, atyatishtad dashangulam, I am 10 inches above. That means I am perfectly pure. Purity, impurity belongs to only to the instruments. Reflecting medium has impurity. Therefore, that's the third argument. And the fourth argument related to it is, I am akhandam. Akhandam is unbroken. That means there is no divisions of any kind. Therefore, I cannot have avidya. Brahman cannot have avidya. Brahman cannot have ignorance, because Brahman is pure, absolute, uninterrupted. That prajnana ghanam. That means homogeneous mass of pure consciousness. So the avidya rests with the instruments of reflection, and that's what has to be understood. And therefore, I can change, polish it, then avidya becomes a vidya, can be removed. Avidya can be removed by vidya, and that's what is the jnanam is involved. This is what we understand. What is the locus of avidya is being analyzed. That's why we need to know exactly what Advaitic principles are in order to understand. We'll go into more details later. Now with this we'll stop here. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.